Hi, this is Mad About Markets, and as we come back from the Diwali break and a break from sending and receiving so many gifts, we have the logistics companies to thank for, especially for people like me who had so much last-minute gifting to do all over the country, Manglam.
None of them came to me, though.
Well, you're right here. We can talk about that.
Don't give me dry fruit. Don't give me son papri. But like, I take your point. You know, a lot of these guys, logistics guys, coming to your house, delivering good news, gifts, and then asking for bakshish.
Yes.
But in the meanwhile, what also happened last week, we did see the delivery company or delivery filing for the IPO paper.
Yeah.
So definitely logistics is on top of mind. So that's what we're talking about. The logistics sector in India on the throes of transformation. That's on top of mind this week on Mad About Markets. So let's talk about logistics as a whole. What constitutes logistics in India and the world? There are three components to logistics. There's road, rail and air, as well as cross-border. That's the transportation part of the logistics. Apart from that, you have warehousing and supply chain as well. But in transport, road is the biggest component. Out there, it includes a full truck of goods that you may want to transport. If you do not have a full truck of goods, there will be players who will take part truck of your goods as well. And then there is express parcel delivery. That's about the transport part. Warehousing, on the other part, is where goods are stored before they're dispatched to the destination. It could be a port, near factories, near markets, temperature control. So that's where you store goods before they are dispatched. And the third component is the supply chain, which is essentially a combination of all the three things that we're talking about. Basically, companies that manage end-to-end supply solutions, whether it's managing sea shipments, road or rail transport from factories to markets to raw materials to finished goods to warehouses. So it's the supply chain solutions companies who are the key link here.
Okay, now that you've given us this picture, let's talk about the kind of opportunity that the Indian logistics sector presents, and let's crunch some numbers to understand that. Now, with a direct spend of $216 billion as of FY20, that was the size of the logistics market, which is expected to grow to $365 billion by FY26 at a compounded annual growth rate of 9% plus. Now, what does it comprise of? Transport, that comprises of nearly 70% of the overall logistics market share. So out of the $216 billion that we spoke about, the transportation sector alone accounted for $151 billion. Then, of course, you have your warehousing and supply chain, which together make up the rest of the 30% if we break that up. Now, further diving into transport, road accounted for the lion's share, which was followed by rail, cross-border and air. So that is what makes up the $151 billion market share of the transport logistics in India.
All right, so you've spoken about what it constitutes. Now let's talk about who are these players. And we would have seen all of them on the roads while driving to one place or the other. We see all of them. So let's talk about the full truckload people. They have delivery, there is TCI, there are VRL logistics among the key players in the segment. But if you don't want to ship an entire truck full of goods, you can opt for part truckload players. And this is big business too, and increasingly growing. Next, we come to the super fast express parcel delivery, the backbone of all e-commerce deliveries, and this has the likes of Blue Dart Delivery, Gati, as well as some others. All Cargo and Gateway Distri Parks, on the other hand, are your go-to companies when it comes to cross-border logistics, be it air or shipping. And then, if you want to transport things via rail, the biggest of them all is Container Corp, over 80% market share, and the other one is Gateway Distri Parks as well. While for the whole hog, the supply chain service providers, we do have all of them, Snowman, Mahindra Logistics, TCI, DHL, as well as delivery itself. So these are basically the kind of logistics players that we have in the country.
Well, now that we're familiar with all the different kinds of players in the logistics market, let's also talk about some of the challenges and opportunities that they face. Now, first, the opportunities. Now, logistics in India, unfortunately, is highly fragmented, and to date, 85% of the transporters own less than 20 trucks. When it comes to warehousing, over 90% of warehouses are smaller than 10,000 square feet each. So that is how fragmented the market is. Now this, going forward, of course, this is the warehousing space. It opens up the opportunity for consolidation and further growth from here. Now, secondly, organized players, they accounted for only 3.5% of the logistics market. However, they are expected to grow much faster at a compounded rate of more than 35% over the next few years before they become larger. Now, thirdly, total logistics spending in India, that is a major lag because we spend almost 14% of the GDP on logistics costs, which is significantly higher than developed countries like China, US and Europe, where the global average is somewhere around 8%. So there's lots of room for improvement.
There is lots of room for improvement in the existing players, and there is a lot of opportunity for new businesses as well. We keep talking about e-commerce out here, D2C and the big boom, right? That itself is a big growth driver for the logistics sector. We have the express parcel delivery, which currently accounts for just 2% of the overall market, and that is expected to grow to 5%, which in terms of numbers means that $2.3 billion in terms of express delivery likely to grow all the way up to $10 to $12 billion. And what does that mean in terms of volumes? E-commerce parcels were almost 1.5 billion in FY20. That's telling you 150 crore parcels were shipped. And this number itself is likely to jump all the way up to 900 crore by FY26. And finally, the availability of value-added services. All these logistics companies provide you some services like cash on delivery, return logistics, don't like a product, return it, the logistics company will go ahead and send it back and give you easy replacement. What this does is enables e-commerce providers to give a superior experience to their customers, and the economic growth of tier 2 plus towns and the increasing penetration of e-commerce out there with the internet, reliable turnaround, all of that is what they need, and all of that is a big, big opportunity for all these logistics players.
It is. Let us talk to some of those logistics players to further understand that. Deepak Garg, the founder and CEO of Rivigo, joins us on the program. And also joining us is Sandeep Barasia, the Chief Business Officer of Delivery. Sandeep and Deepak, thanks very much for joining us on the show here. Sandeep, to you first. You know, what is the kind of addressable opportunity for the logistics sector in numbers? What's your sense?
Logistics, as we like to more sort of broadly call it supply chain, has to play a critical role in the growth of the economy, right? If we are going to get to that 5 trillion target, that 5 trillion GDP target that we have, well, logistics and supply chain have to play a very, very important role. Goods have to move. Everything that's manufactured in the country eventually has to get to the consumer. So goods have to move from, whether it's B2B movement from factory to factory or factory to retailer or even cross-border. And then, of course, eventually from a retailer or a warehouse to the end consumer. Goods simply have to move. So there's a large underlying opportunity. In 2020, the market estimate for logistics in India was over $200 billion. Some estimates suggest that over the next 5 to 6 years, say by FY26, this will be over $350 billion, growing at over 9% CAGR per annum. So that's a huge, 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 huge market. The base market itself is quite large, and then there's a lot of growth coming on top of that over the next 5-6 years.
You know, that's an interesting parallel that you draw. If the economy is $5 trillion and logistics has to be just about 10% of that, it's much above what the street was expecting. Logistics market could actually be as big as $500 billion. But let's go across to Deepak then. Deepak, what are the opportunities ahead? Which sectors do you think are revenue generating, margin accretive for logistic players like you?
So look, we are serving almost every sector of the economy, FMCG, electricals, electronics, publications, auto, pharma, and so on and so forth. I think through the last year, pharma, healthcare, e-commerce, electronic sectors have grown significantly. Auto has been reasonably mild, but our expectation is in the coming year or two, auto sector will also kind of bounce back and grow strongly. For us, I think this is also about gaining market share. We're very small compared to the size of the market itself. Road transportation is a $100 billion market. And we are trying to organize that market and infusing more technology in that market. So I think we are not as much dependent from here on the market sentiments, but our own ability to scale up our technology and our platforms and associate as many entrepreneurs on the platform who will see success by working through the platform.
Interesting there, Sandeep. Earlier you said about $350 billion, that'll be the size of the market over the next few years. What will be the big growth drivers, and especially the role that will be played by e-commerce, which is one of the fastest growth drivers, I believe, for the logistics sector?
Well, there are lots of growth drivers for supply chain going forward. You know, The number one, of course, as I outlined right at the start, is that the underlying industry is still growing very, very rapidly. You know, 9% CAGR is not small. So there's massive growth. There is also a shift from unorganized to organized players as sort of the demand, the expectation of customers is starting to change. Now, e-commerce does play a very, very critical role in this because it is, in some ways, showing the way of how supply chain can actually become much more efficient than it was in the past. Firstly, e-commerce requires enormous amount of speed. End consumers are expecting their goods to arrive same day, next day, in 2 days' time, across the country, right? And those goods have to move all over the country. You know, there are goods manufactured in Bangalore that are going to Delhi, that are manufactured northeast. You know, we're taking a whole bunch of goods to the northeast. And you have this whole concept of the endless aisle because shoppers can now shop 24/7 and the aisle doesn't stop. So they have access to all the inventory out there in the country. So it's no longer about, okay, this is what is available. You know, this pair of shoes available in the store on this particular size. If that fits you, great. In online, there is no such thing. So we are constantly moving goods. And so the speed, the precision of that actually becomes extremely, extremely important.
All right, Sandeep and Deepak, hold your thoughts there. I think you've given us plenty to think about when it comes to the opportunity. So let's also talk about the challenges. Now, the biggest one being inefficiency and fragmentation, which has raised costs because historically complex indirect taxation structure before the GST regime has led to a lot of impediment when it comes to smooth interstate movement of goods. And as a result, traditional players remain regional and subscale. Therefore, there were significant inefficiencies. Also, there's poor road transport infrastructure, which means Indian trucks travel approximately only 325 kilometers a day, which is significantly lower compared to the global average of 500 to 800 kilometers, and therefore longer turnaround time, higher fuel and maintenance cost, and the opportunity cost of lost business. Now, the Indian logistics sector is also characterized by pilferage, damage, and wastage because of these inefficiencies. There's also prolonged underinvestment by incumbents, which has been a challenge. So subscale and monoline players have historically been reluctant to upgrade their network through investment in critical technology and infrastructure. So they're fraught with challenges, even if there are some opportunities.
That's correct. And that is what brings or makes the space rife for a lot of disruption by the new players. Hmm. And that's something that we've witnessed as well. 10-year-old delivery, that's going public. Remember, it's the largest supply chain company in India in terms of revenue, has 20% share in the e-commerce parcel delivery, is one of the biggest beneficiaries out there, looking to raise almost $1 billion. Rivigo, that's the other one that started an interesting disruptive concept. It uses algorithms to develop intelligent driver allocation system that picks the driver for duty and allows equal driving hour. What this basically means is that if you're taking a truck from Delhi to Mumbai, it won't be the same driver taking it from Delhi to Mumbai. Instead, one will go from Delhi, go all the way up to Agra. There will be another driver that will take the truck further, and the driver from Agra will come back to Delhi. It is a relay model in which the drivers need not go from one place to the other. The truck goes from one place to the other. The other players, we have kinds of Ship Rocket and a lot of these software as a service players who have made a big inroads into India's logistics space.
Well, Deepak, thanks for standing by, and Sandeep as well. Deepak, you know, what is the level of efficiency that you've actually been able to achieve because of this relay trucking model, which Mangalam was just describing? I mean, has it disrupted the industry really?
You know, if you look at the quality of life an average truck driver is living now attached to the relay trucking model, he's coming back home every day. He's earning similar or more, but saving a lot more compared to the traditional trucking model. In a traditional trucking model, he would spend months away from home. Second, you would see faster transit time. So on an average on Indian roads, you would see transit speeds of 25 to 30 kilometers an hour with a lot of stops in between. In the relay trucking model, this number goes up to 45 to 50 kilometers an hour, which means you have roughly half the transit time on the highways. As a result, you see an impact on the cost structure because you're able to utilize the capital equipment a lot more and are able to source truck drivers from the hinterlands in the villages. Your cost structure goes down, and as the trucks are becoming more and more expensive, this difference of cost structure will continue to increase between relay trucking and the non-relay trucking.
phenomenal model there. You know, let's see whether how it scales up and whether there are challenges you face when you do that or not. But Sandeep, you know, logistics is a competitive space. Legacy players, they've made decent inroads. What have you learned from the traditional players, and what do you think you can teach them?
It's not so much about traditional players versus or legacy players versus the new players. I think the market overall is ripe for disruption. Historically, the Indian market has actually been highly, highly fragmented. And there have been legacy issues like not having a single tax structure across the country, which have kept players very marginalized, very small and regional in nature, focused on monoline. They just did one part of logistics rather than doing all of it. Historically, they've never really invested in technology or talent or automation. And that's starting to change because the market demand is starting to change. Whether it's B2B or B2C, customers are expecting a lot more from the supply chain partners. And I think just coping up with that, I think requires a whole different mindset going forward.
Well, Deepak, let's also talk about the model and the kind of capital you need, because, you know, half of your revenue is going in losses. How long do you think you can sustain without external funding? And do you, like Delivery, also have IPO plans then?
So I don't think we'll require another round of funding for our primary capital needs before the IPO. And our belief is, post-COVID, we'd see a huge amount of scale-up. There's a lot of demand right now in the market. And we believe we'll go for IPO in 2024, so about two and a half years from now. I don't expect too much of primary capital requirement till then.
Deepak, Sandeep, you've given us a lot of food for thought on the logistics sector. So we'll take a short break. On the other side, we'll focus on the bigger question. What will it take for the Indian logistics industry to finally deliver growth?
We're going to pose that question to our guests, so stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. You're watching us on Mad About Markets. We're talking about the India's logistics sector, and we have with us Deepak Garg of Rivigo and Sandeep Barasia of Delivery. The spotlight remains on the logistics sector, and the bigger question that we're asking today, what will it take for the Indian logistics industry to finally deliver growth? Sandeep, to you.
So I think the legacy issues that have plagued the industry have to be addressed now. So I think the most important thing is going to be investment in technology and automation and data sciences. I think that is actually going to be critical. You have to see emergence of scale players in this industry. India is an analogous market. Large economies spawn large logistics companies. You know, if you look at the US, you have the likes of FedEx and UPS. If you look at China, there are several large logistics companies that have emerged in China. If you look at Europe, you've got DHL. But India is it's an unusual market because we are one of the largest economies in the world, but we've never really spawned a very, very large logistics and supply chain company. So I think the element of both scale combined with technology and data sciences is going to be critical for the growth of logistics. The good thing is, a lot of the framework that will actually enable this, the government's already put in place. The regulatory framework actually is very supportive of actually driving efficiency in supply chain, whether it's in the form of GST and all the stuff that's happened with things like e-way bills, et cetera, but also all the investment that's going into improving road infrastructure and connectivity and multimodal and things like that. So I think we have all the right ingredients to really drive a very exciting and a bright future for logistics and supply chain in India.
Deepak, what's your sense? What will it take? And if you could put some numbers to the kind of growth that we may see in the future.
Typically, logistics grows at about 1.3 to 1.4x of the GDP. And nominal GDP at that time was growing at about 12 to 14%, or even touched 15% through several years. So this growth varied between 15 to even 20 to 23%. Coupled with that, in that also subsegments grew actually at 25-30%. So express industry grew at 25-30% during that period of time. In China's build out period, express logistics grew at 50% CAGR for the last 15 years. So So there's a huge amount of potential we'd see in the next 10 to 15 years in this sector.
All right, Deepak and Sandeep, thanks so much for your time. So that was about the logistics sector. Let's now head into what we call In Case You Missed It. Now, unless you've been living under a rock, it's quite unlikely that you've missed the big buzz around the initial public offering of Paytm, the biggest IPO to date that India has had. But what you may have missed is just how staggering the numbers are. Now, the IPO is expected to value Paytm at 66 to 79 times its operating revenue, which is a steep premium over 25 times revenue multiple compared to its global peers. Now, demand from domestic investors has also been quite muted, Mangalam.
That's correct. You know, so the domestic mutual funds have asked for just around four of the domestic mutual funds have gone ahead and applied in the anchor book of Paytm. And that means that their overall anchor demand for Paytm is almost 30% lower on average as against the other new age businesses companies, the likes of Nykaa, Zomato, or even Policybazaar. All right, so that's about the Paytm IPO. But before we bid goodbye, we'll leave you with what's lit. And here again, it's a big new IPO that has come in the new business. A bumper stock market debut for Nykaa, hitting a market capitalization of 1 lakh crore on its debut day. This makes Nykaa the 55th most valuable company listed on the Indian bourses. And what a journey.
And what a journey it has been, both for the company and its founder, Falguni Nair, who started the company at the age of 50. Now, one of those rare new age businesses that is also profitable and a unicorn at that. We leave you with the precious moments from the listing ceremony and see you same time next week. 11.